Thank you. Could I ask those members who are leaving the chamber to now do so quickly and quietly, because we will be continuing with our business, which in fact is a members' business debate. And that is the final item of business, and it's on a motion in the name of Graeme Simpson, 14024, on retrofitting tenement maintenance. This debate will be concluded without any questions being put. I would ask those members who would wish to speak in the debate to press the request to speak buttons. And I call on Graeme Simpson to open the debate. Up to 7 minutes, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And can I start by apologising first to my colleagues for them having to listen to me twice today. And I did spot the ones who filed out the chamber. And also for the length of the motion, which is frankly ludicrous, and I've poked fun at others for producing similar epics in the past. So I deserve whatever ridicule comes my way, but as members may recall, I'd originally tabled a motion on tenement maintenance and the Scottish Law Commission's consultation on the issue, and that was well before recess. It got immediate cross-party support, and it could have been debated, but sadly my whip's office preferred other topics, so here we are. The delay has allowed me, there is a benefit, because it's allowed me to encompass retrofitting, which is very much linked indeed. So can I thank all the members who have signed the new, longer motion. There's always been cross-party interest in this important topic, which affects so many lives. In March 2018, some of us established a working group to see what we could suggest to improve the condition of Scotland's tenements. Around a third of tenement flats were built prior to 1919, another third between 1919 and 1982, and the final third after 1982. Many tenement flats were in a state of critical disrepair when we started our work, and are probably worse now. Members will know from their casework the difficulties that people can have in getting work done to shared buildings. People can wait years sometimes to get agreement to get essential work done, like fixing roofs. And existing tenement law is not strong enough to get us to a place where our housing stock is brought up to scratch, maintained and made fit for the future. Housing impacts on people's lives. It can affect your health, physical and mental, your work, relationships, your well-being. Living in poor housing is depressing, and no one should have to put up with it. Now, I accept the subject of this debate may appear to be a little dry to some, but there is really nothing more important than the condition of where you live. In May 2019, the working group made a number of recommendations. They were that there should be compulsory owners' associations, sinking funds and 5 yearly inspections. We sent our report to the Scottish Government and they produced a work plan. And in May 2022, they asked the Scottish Law Commission to make recommendations, but just on the owners' association proposal. That consultation ran until August the 1st. And I'll talk about that in a second, but you can see that all of this has taken a long time and it's been frustrating. So we reconvened the working group in 2022. I think it's been one of the best examples that I can think of parties working together in this Parliament with outside experts for the common good. We really should see more of this kind of thing. And I want to thank the Law Commission for the work it's doing, and especially Professor Frankie McCarthy, who's leading on it and has become something of an expert on tenement law if she wasn't already. The Scottish Law Commission's discussion paper explores proposals to replace the existing tenement management scheme with an owners' association scheme. And that would make owners' associations compulsory for every tenement building in Scotland, giving these associations the power to enter into contracts and appoint managers. It would also introduce duties for those associations, including an obligation to organise meetings, approve budgets and standardise titles to ensure consistent maintenance rules across tenements. The Law Commission posed 79 questions, and among those were which powers should be made available to owners' associations, who should be eligible to act as the manager of these bodies, and in which circumstances an owner should be able to challenge a majority decision. The results of that consultation, and I believe there was a good response to it, will inform the final recommendations and a draft bill which should be introduced by the Law Commission in 2026, and that will be after the next Scottish Parliament elections. So it will be for whoever is elected then to take this forward, and it will be no easy task, but it is essential. That brings me on to retrofitting. For Scotland to tackle climate change, reducing carbon emissions from existing buildings is critical. Across the UK, 80% of buildings in use in 2050 will have already been built. Well, they actually have already been built, and these could represent 95% of future built environment emissions. Reducing emissions to net zero will require retrofit work on up to 27 million UK domestic and 2 million non-domestic buildings. And according to the Climate Change Committee, £45 billion of investment will be needed for energy efficient improvements in homes up to 2035. These are massive numbers. Today's motion mentions the publication of the report called Meeting Scotland's Retrofit Challenge, Solutions from the Industry. That was jointly published by 14 leading built environment sector organisations. And this followed a retrofit roundtable meeting convened at the Parliament in May last year. The report called on the government to establish a ministerial oversight group on retrofit. It's a complicated cross-portfolio issue in which relevant ministers must be brought together. And it said that they should develop a long-term retrofit delivery plan with a joined-up approach to funding, regulating and incentivising retrofit work across Scotland. The report lists some items that plan should include, such as establishing long-term targets and measurement tools and considering the human resources necessary to undertake retrofit projects properly. That really means skills. And the report also calls for a fabric-first approach, which means that heat conservation repairs and improvements are prioritised before any changes are made to heat generation, such as installing a heat pump. So do work to your property before you put a heat pump in. Presiding Officer, none of this is headline-grabbing. Housing tends not to be until things go wrong. Now, I wrote in my foreword to the Tenement Maintenance Group's report about the tragic death of Australian Christine Foster, who was killed by falling masonry while working in an Edinburgh city centre pub in June 2000, and she was just 26. Her dad called on the government to lay down tougher regulations to ensure safer construction in Scotland, but not much has happened since then, which is why this is so essential. So I look forward to hearing from other members today and the Minister. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Simpson. And I now call Ben McPherson to be followed by Miles Briggs. Mr. McPherson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. First of all, I pay tribute to Graeme Simpson for bringing this issue to the Chamber following the members' debate that I brought and we had in 2018. And there has been much progress since then, including one opposition debate and one government debate, as well as today's. And this is a really important subject, and it's absolutely right that we're having more debates about it in the Parliament. First, I declare an interest as one of around 900,000 people, 900 living in around 900,000 of the tenements in Scotland. And it's something that is relevant to a huge amount of my constituents because, like many of my constituents, I live in a tenement. And the casework I've had on tenement issues throughout the over 8 years I've had the privilege of representing the communities of Edinburgh, North and Leith is significant. People really struggling to get repairs done in their properties. And that's because although the Tenement Act 2004 is a better piece of legislation than was there beforehand, we do not have a suitable legal structure in order to incentivise and necessitate people to organise and finance repair and maintenance of their properties. The work that the group of MSPs and the expert advisers have done over the last 8 years has done a lot of heavy lifting for the government. And I know we have the Climate Change Minister here today, but this is fundamentally actually an issue for the Housing Minister and colleagues, and I hope that today's debate will be brought to their attention. Much of Scotland's tenements are factored, but we know the difficulties, again, from our casework, and indeed from a news item that was reported by BBC Scotland this week, about the difficulties that people have with factoring in terms of delivery and value for money. Some of it's done very well, but it's not something that necessarily every tenement will want to sign up to for various reasons. So we need ways of making sure that tenements are self-organised, necessitated to do that, and have funding available in order to undertake repairs and maintenance. That's where we are. We're nowhere near the point of considering retrofitting. That needs to be done in order to meet our climate obligations, but most importantly, to help make sure that homes are warm and watertight and that quality of life is enhanced. But we've got to make these changes in order to just get to the point of enough repair and maintenance taking place for public safety, for the integrity of people's properties, and also to make sure that our stock is then enhanced in a time when we have a housing crisis. So I absolutely think that this needs more focus from the Parliament as a whole and from the government, because this affects all of urban Scotland, including my constituents. The work that the Scottish Law Commission is doing is excellent. The consultation is important. We then need work on the consideration of sinking funds. And then as a Parliament and as a political community of representatives and parties, we need a shared position of agreement going into the 2026 election, the next Scottish Parliament election, so that this change is one of the first pieces of legislation that is considered in the Parliament in the next parliamentary term. We need to take the time now to work through developing the hard law and the human rights considerations that are part of this, and then in the next parliamentary term, we need to legislate quickly and then implement as soon as possible after that. Because if we don't do that, then we'll not get on to the idea of retrofitting. And I actually think the Heat and Buildings Bill that is going to be brought forward as part of the programme for government is of course worthwhile and important. But actually, people won't be able to undertake the changes that necessitates in tenements unless tenement law is reformed. The practical function and legal operation will not be in place in order to enable retrofit. So we need a new Tenement Act, we need a shared commitment, and this debate is an important step forward in it.
Thank you, Mr McPherson. I call Miles Briggs to be followed by Mark Griffin.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I start by thanking my colleague, Graeme Simpson, for bringing forward this important debate, and also the organisations who provided helpful briefings for it. And also to pay tribute to both Graeme Simpson and Ben McPherson for their campaigning on tenement issues. I think that's important. And the CPG on housing and the work which has been going on in Parliament as well. I think it's really important that that then comes to the floor of the chamber. And one of the first cases I received when I was elected 8 years ago was in relation to stair cleaning of a tenement here in the capital. It was in relation to shared payments towards communal cleaning and communal maintenance issues. And to some extent, 8 years on, it doesn't feel like we've made any progress on that. And I have to say, it was a very good early lesson as a new MSP on the legal pitfalls and problems often facing people living in tenements and the need for organised and legal frameworks to help improve the conditions of all tenements across Scotland and people who call them home. As a motion for debate tonight highlights, there is a pressing need for solutions to be developed. As was highlighted in the recent Meeting Scotland's Retrofit Challenge publication, coordinated by the Chartered Institute of Building and jointly published by 14 leading organisations from across the built environment sector, retrofit is complicated, multifaceted, cross-portfolio challenge, for which there will be no silver bullet solution. So we need to look towards what will be these problems and actually pitfalls for the future to achieve net zero in tenements across Scotland, and for that legal framework to be developed sooner rather than later. And I do agree with what Ben McPherson just said there. I think we will find that the net zero legislation in the heat and building strategy does not fit tenement law in Scotland, so won't make the progress early on. So we need that joined up holistic policy making approach, which will be needed to reach Scotland's targets and ensure that our existing buildings are not only warm, energy efficient, but also promote the health and well-being of those who live in them and use them as well. As such, the Meeting Scotland's Retrofit Challenge document acts as a welcome focus, I think, on how government can identify opportunities and remove and mitigate barriers which we know exist in a number of key recommendations. And I think really getting to the heart of some of this work is the work which the Local Government and Housing Committee recently undertook with regards to the cladding remediation bill. Many of the challenges we face with surveying buildings, access to buildings, etc., will be the same. So the government are already aware of the challenges which the cladding bill has faced, emergency legislation taken through. I think we will see the exact same challenges coming forward around tenements as well. That's why the Scottish Law Commission's discussion paper, I think, does represent a welcome step, first step maybe, in establishing the necessary governance structures to address the maintenance of homes across Scotland, in particular tenement buildings operating within what is a complex multi-tenure system, and something we need to, I think, get to grips with sooner rather than later. And as Graeme Simpson has stated, the development of a compulsory owners association I think is a way of taking that forward, to actually look towards a solution-driven approach where, regardless of who owns each flat in a tenement property, we get that group effort and group funding of, let's face it, what will be expensive works. The proposals, therefore, by the Law Commission's report provide that legal framework to help take forward the powers and duties, and if adopted into legislation and suitable guidance and advice, I think we can therefore look towards making owners' associations, managers and the individuals who will also want to be at the heart of this, individual property owners, have that suitable legal framework to move forward with retrofit in the future. To conclude, Deputy Presiding Officer, for those of us who do represent communities with a large number of tenements, it's clear that we will face a number of challenges, both existing and future, especially in relation to retrofit of tenement properties. But I believe the next Parliament, as Ben McPherson and also Graeme Simpson have outlined, needs to look now, and we collectively, cross-party, need to look at what actions can be taken early on in the next Parliament, a commitment from all parties, for example, to a tenement maintenance bill in the next session of Parliament, I think can build on the really positive work which has taken place, the solutions which have been developed, sometimes not by government, but by outside bodies, and we can make sure that we get solutions in place for people living in tenements, because they need these solutions. And to go back to my constituent I met 8 years ago, we need to make sure that these issues are addressed. They haven't. And all of us in this chamber have an opportunity to help fix that. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Briggs. I call Mark Griffin to be followed by Stuart McMillan. Mr. Griffin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I want to start my contribution by congratulating my Central Scotland regional colleague, Graeme Simpson, on securing this debate this evening. It's an important issue, something that we haven't covered regularly enough, and so I'm glad that we're getting the chance to discuss it in Parliament this evening, because buildings are one of the highest emitting sectors in Scotland, behind only industry and transport. One in five of Scotland's homes are traditionally built, and heat leaks out of those tenements, historic windows and walls. In the UK, the new Labour government has pledged an extra £6.6 billion over the next parliamentary term towards its warm home plans, and I'm hoping that the Scottish Government can work with colleagues in the UK Government to make that plan a reality in homes across Scotland too. And although that we have discussed this before, we have known that we have to bring our homes up to standard for a long time. We still actually haven't worked out the nuts and bolts of how we will do it and, crucially, how we will finance it. Retrofitting homes in Scotland remains complicated and, crucially, too expensive for lots of homeowners now struggling with mortgage payments as well. Yep, certainly.
Ben McPherson.
In good faith, with Mark Griffin join with me in believing that there's an important point of consideration that many of the campaigners and those involved in the working group have put forward before about could we reduce VAT on retrofitting and home improvements in order to help people afford and facilitate it.
Mark Griffin.
Absolutely, and that's something that I've called on previous colours of UK governments to do as well. There is clearly an imbalance with the VAT structure where improvements are not covered by VAT, but you see new build houses which have changes, adaptations made at the request of the customer to avoid that VAT bill further down the line once they take ownership. So it's something I'm more than happy to work on a cross-party basis on, because it's clearly something that's going to be critical when it comes to retrofitting the many houses that we need to retrofit to bring them up to standards to meet our obligations on net zero and climate change and fuel poverty too. So I'm more than happy to work with Mr McPherson and any others on continuing lobbying attempts for that. I think it will be crucial, especially because, particularly with our older homes, they're all uniquely built. They've all, as well as being uniquely built, a lot of them have been uniquely modified over the years in many different ways. So it's not as simple enough as just to come up with a one-size-fits-all solutions. They're all modified in different ways, used in different ways by the occupants. And the Tenement Maintenance Working Group has shown that the laws, as well as the complication around technical solutions, the laws surrounding tenement maintenance add an extra layer of complexity to matters surrounding retrofit. So it is reassuring to know that industry experts are engaged with addressing those thorny issues. I was pleased to read the Meeting Scotland's Retrofit Challenge solutions from the industry following the Retrofit Roundtables meeting in May 2023. The report and recommendation of that group forms, I think, a vital first step towards retrofitting our homes quickly and effectively. I also note the recommendations of the Tenement Maintenance Working Group, which includes compulsory owners' associations for tenements which would have a legal personality and the ability to enter contracts in its own name. But legislating for that initiative does raise some questions around the interaction of a potential new law with existing tenement title conditions, and maybe as well potential concerns about compliance with property rights of flat owners under articles on human rights. Now, the work of the Scottish Law Commission on mandatory owners' association for tenements in Scotland is therefore invaluable for us, particularly as it should hopefully inform the government's thinking, whichever government comes to office in 2026. It's crucial that they lean heavily on the work being done just now by the Law Commission, because lowering emissions from Scotland's housing stock is essential for reducing fuel poverty, and if we're to get to net zero, 2.25 million homes in Scotland, including almost 900,000 tenements, need to be retrofitted. But, Presiding Officer, I'm grateful for the hard work of all of the organisations previously mentioned in the debate. With 48% of our buildings in critical disrepair and spiralling fuel costs for our residents.
Mr Griffin, I hope you're bringing your remarks to a close.
I am, Presiding Officer, and it's a critical element of lifting Scotland out of the housing emergency and alleviating through poverty. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Griffin. I now call Stuart McMillan to be followed by Ariane Burgess. Mr McMillan.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. First of all, Presiding Officer, I want to thank Graeme Simpson for securing this debate, and I attended a number of the working group meetings prior to the COVID pandemic, and want to put my record my thanks to Mr Simpson and also his predecessor, Ben McPherson, for taking forward this much needed work. The Working Group on Maintenance of Tenement Scheme Property Final Recommendations Report, published in 2019, which Graham Simpson referenced, for me is a hugely important document published by any aspect of this Parliament. My own constituency, like others across the Chamber, has many tenements in the constituency. Many of us will have an acute knowledge of the condition of these tenements because of our constituents and the issues that they raise, in addition to, for a light-hearted moment, in addition to the morning leaflet runs that we will all do when it comes round to election periods, and also surveys and delivering of annual reports. Now, there are many stunning tenements across the country, well-maintained and also in very much a good condition. But, regrettably, there are many that are also in a poor or a very poor state. Now, this is down to a variety of reasons. Some residents might not have the finance to make the repairs. Some residents might not want to make the repairs if the issue doesn't affect them. And also there are this issue of absentee landlords who are not willing to contribute. These are just three examples. There will be many, many more. Now, this leads to buildings becoming undesirable and people becoming effectively trapped in a property. This has a negative effect also upon the local community. Now, Inverclyde, unfortunately, has many people in negative equity as their property has reduced in value over the years and as repairs certainly just haven't just taken place. Now, this in effect means that they cannot sell and they often cannot afford to pay their share of the communal repair costs. It's a vicious cycle and something does need to be done. And this is where the work of the Tenement Working Group genuinely is hugely important. I've already heard from colleagues across the Chamber in terms of the importance of getting some type of outcome, some type of result on this. Now, I agree with the comments from my colleague Ben McPherson when he spoke about the Heat and Buildings Bill that was announced in the programme for government. I agree with him regarding the aspect of a tenement bill to come forward. Now, this is where the work of the Scottish Law Commission is hugely important. There was Graham Simpson, will recall from our early days in this session in the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee. I think it's fair to say that we pushed the boundaries and the envelope of what that committee could be doing and should be doing with regards to the work, with regards to the work of the SLC in this regard. And obviously, one of the recommendations that we did undertake was to refer it to the relevant committee in the Scottish Parliament. But that didn't stop the dialogue with the SLC, which is hugely important. Now, I think we would all recognise and accept that the length of time it's taking for the SLC work is a long period of time. That was one of the frustrations that we did have in the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee. But the fact this issue has been on for so long, if it does take that wee bit extra time to get it right, I would much rather that as compared to at some point in the next session and the session after to then go back and try to fix a problem that we could get right at the very outset. So I think so the point that Ben McPherson spoke about regarding the factoring, obviously this was touched upon very much earlier on today, but also in the report. The factoring is one of the key and crucial problems that we face. My constituency, out of the 32 authorities, we are number five in terms of the number of tenements. So I know how important this issue is, trying to help my constituents. And it is a huge frustration. But with the work that the SLC are undertaking, I genuinely believe that if that can be done right, then we can make a hugely positive difference for future generations across the country. Now, whether it's the VAT issue is included in this or not, we'll see what happens in that in terms of going forward. But I think this particular problem is one of the key problems that the country faces. And that's even before we get to the retrofitting, which is hugely important as well, of course, for climate change. But if we can get the tenement bit sorted, then I would like to think that the Heating Buildings Bill that's going to come in, if that can have that flexibility inbuilt, so when the tenement bill comes forward, potentially in the next session after the SLC, then anyone who actually lives in a tenement, anyone who owns a tenement, will be in a better place to deal with it and then move forward so that all of our communities can be in a better place. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms McMillan. I call Arianne Burgess to be followed by Paul Sweeney. Ms Burgess.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'd like to also thank Graham Simpson for bringing this important issue to the Chamber. It's time to get serious about retrofitting our building stock to meet our climate goals, not just tenements, but all of Scotland's housing stock. And the report, Meeting Scotland's Retrofit Challenge, Solutions from the Industry, is a wake-up call for the government. Rather than repeating what's been said, I'll highlight a few points from the report, but also that have come up in the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee and the work of the Existing Homes Alliance. First, we absolutely need a fabric-first approach to retrofitting. And this means improving the building envelope, walls, roofs, floors, windows and doors before installing new technology. Proper insulation is key. Without it, advanced heating technology is just a waste of money. By focusing on the building fabric first, we can maximise energy efficiency and provide long-term benefits to homeowners. Too many people are installing heat pumps in leaky buildings, leading to higher energy bills. This could be avoided with bespoke whole building plans. Each house or tenement needs a tailored approach, considering its unique characteristics. A one-size-fits-all solution won't work for Scotland's diverse housing stock. Tailored plans ensure retrofitting is effective and efficient, saving energy and improving comfort. We must push the new Labour government to remove the 20% VAT on retrofitting buildings and for the Scottish Government to give powers to local authorities to raise a demolition levy. The current VAT setup disincentivises contractors and slows down progress. Removing this tax would make retrofitting more affordable and accelerate our efforts to cut carbon emissions from heating. As well as moving us to our climate ambitions, retrofitting could also help us tackle homelessness through the retrofit and adaptive reuse of the countless empty properties across Scotland. We could create three homes through retrofitting for the price of one new build. Communities and councils have been leading the way on this, with work done by Midsteeple Quarter in Dumfries and by Argyll and Bute Council and Perth and Kinross Council, for example. And support is needed to help these leaders share best practice. We also need a local approach to engage private homeowners and the private rented sector. The Existing Homes Alliance is doing great work here, and we need to do more. Leveraging climate action networks and hubs could be a game changer. These networks can spread information through local events, raising awareness and providing guidance to homeowners and landlords to take the step. This grassroots approach ensures the retrofitting message reaches all corners of Scotland, encouraging widespread participation. I also welcome the publication of the Scottish Law Commission's discussion paper on the proposed scheme for owners' associations. And I listened with interest at Stuart McMillan's contribution on some of the issues that he is aware of. The proposal for every tenement building in Scotland to have an owners' association is a sensible and necessary step. It exists in tenements in New York City, where I lived for 20 years, and these associations will ensure maintenance work is carried out efficiently and costs are fairly distributed among owners. And I agree with Ben McPherson on the urgency of bringing forward this work at the start of next session. Whole building flat plans could fit well in this model. The government must incentivise technological innovation on heat distribution networks for whole tenements, but also for heat source technology that could be easily installed in individual flats. And in conclusion, I urge the Scottish Government to act swiftly on the recommendations of both the Retrofit Report and the Scottish Law Commission's discussion paper by adopting a fabric-first approach, creating whole house plans, removing the VAT on retrofitting and bringing in demolition levy, engaging local communities through action networks, and incentivising innovation in heat technology, we can make significant strides towards more sustainable, energy efficient and well-maintained built environment in Scotland. Let's seize this opportunity and get on with the urgent work that will ensure we meet our legally binding climate obligations.
Thank you, Ms. Burgess. I now call Paul Sweeney to be followed by John Mason. Mr. Sweeney.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and I congratulate Mr. Simpson for securing this timely debate. And as he highlighted in his speech, it isn't just a matter of self-interest of owners of buildings. It's a public health emergency in Scotland, frankly, because one of the essential components of any hierarchy of needs is shelter and security in your home. And indeed, the condition of Scotland's housing stock leaves a lot to be desired. It's certainly some of the oldest housing stock in Europe. and in the case of Glasgow, it has been a perennial challenge for the city to deal with for over a century. If we go back a century ago to the 1924 Housing Act, it was created in the spirit of trying to address some of the sanitation issues with housing in Glasgow, but focused largely on the construction of new municipal housing estates and didn't tackle the inner city tenement challenges and the collapse of factoring that took place after the emergency legislation that was introduced in 1915 to restrict rents. As laudable as it was at the time, it wasn't revised or amended, and as a result, there was no factoring of tenements in Glasgow for half a century. Fast forward to the post-war period, we had the emergency slum clearances in the city, the building of overspill estates, and new towns, which were also intended to address that problem. But the result was the designation of large parts of the city of Glasgow as comprehensive development areas, 29 in total, which entailed the demolition within the space of 30 years of 40% of Glasgow's housing stock. An extraordinary figure. 40% of the city's houses were demolished in 30 years. That's the scale of the challenge we face going forward if we don't deal with this. The scale of the maintenance backlog in Glasgow has been highlighted by the City Council. They recently conducted a survey which highlighted that 46,600 tenement properties in the city are in an urgent state of disrepair. The maintenance backlog runs to £2.9 billion. That is an urgent crisis. The City Heritage Trust, of which I'm a trustee, has an annual budget of £1 million to dispense in grants. As you can imagine, that's an absurdly inadequate figure. But also, our own structures for how we actually assist people to improve their tenements isn't adequate. Grant funding alone is not sufficient. We need to be much more intelligent about providing patient loan finance to property owners to carry out much greater scale of improvements to properties and to address these fundamental fabric challenges. In Glasgow alone, we have 76,000 buildings, residential buildings, which are predating the First World War, of which about 70,000 are tenements. So about one in four Glaswegians live in a tenement building built before the First World War. And there are big challenges there, but we also have to take hope in the solutions that Glasgow found a generation ago in the 1970s. Many people of a certain generation will be familiar with the kludgy. So that my grandparents talked about the toilet in the shared stair, and the seat was always warm. That came about as a result of the 1892 Police Borough Act, which insisted on indoor sanitation, but not necessarily indoor toilets in an individual private flat. It was only until the 1970s when actually in Scotland, one in four Scots had no toilet in their own home. They had to share a toilet. But by 1990, Scotland had the best toileted nation in Europe. And that didn't come about by accident. It came about by the innovations that were carried out in Govan and in Partick and other districts in Glasgow. People like Raymond Young, a young architect who was involved with Assist Architects, an experimental practice which spun out of Strathclyde University's architecture department. He went to meet a lady called Annie Gibbons on Lewis Street in Govan. And she said, "I've heard all about your work on putting indoor toilets into flats. I want one." So she became the experiment, the guinea pig, in putting an indoor toilet into a tenement. And eventually, the housing convener of the city, Pat Lally, came to cut the ribbon on her toilet. But what they had realised, they'd spent the last 30 years demolishing 100,000 tenements, when actually they'd been better deploying those resources in retrofit. As a result, the growth of the Community Housing Association movement took place in Glasgow with the passing of the 1974 Housing Act. That formed the basis in which we're talking about now, owners' associations, sinking funds, the management of properties. And as a result, about a quarter of the city's housing stock in Glasgow is managed by registered social landlords, about 80 housing associations in total in Glasgow. So the infrastructure is there. We've done it before. We have committed with positive action, a coherence and the sort of consensual approach that the member for Edinburgh Northern Leith talked about, and solved a major social problem in Scotland. We moved people from sharing toilets in the 1970s, one in four Scots, to having the best toileted nation in Europe. We can do the same with other fabric repairs now, but we need to implement urgently the recommendations that the Tenement Maintenance Working Group has identified in concert with the Law Commission. We cannot continue to dawdle on this. We've seen the pathway. We can pilot a lot of this stuff with the existing infrastructure we have. We can look at our housing associations, and we can get ahead of the problem in Glasgow. We can actually start to affect the practical operation of this very early in a city like Glasgow. And I'd urge members to look at how we move forward with that. And I certainly know the Law Commission are keen to look at those pilots so they can then, you know, write the legislation to reflect the reality. Let's move ahead with that, because there's big opportunities. And if we can do this, we can solve a lot of the problems that Scotland now faces with its housing. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Sweeney. I would advise members that due to the number of members who wish to speak in this debate, I am minded to accept a motion without notice under Rule 8.14.3 to extend the debate by up to 30 minutes. I now invite Graeme Simpson to move a motion without notice.
Moved.
Thank you, Mr. Simpson. The question is that the debate be extended by up to 30 minutes. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
That is agreed, and I now call John Mason to be followed by Carol Mockin. Mr. Mason.
Thank you very much, and thanks to Graeme Simpson for bringing forward today's debate. There has been cross-party concern about tenement maintenance since Ben McPherson originally led the working group, and I think all of us as independent MSPs share this concern as well. It is great that the Scottish Government has responded positively, and the Scottish Law Commission are proposing a way forward, in particular proposing that every tenement building should have an owners' association. I have to say that many of us have been frustrated at the slow progress, but I guess any progress is better than none. And we need to accept that politically, some of the proposals may be unpopular, for example, once we get onto the subject of reserves or sinking funds. However, we need to remember that tenement buildings, and I live in one myself, are gradually deteriorating day by day and year by year. Where I live in Burlanock was at an area of post-war council housing in Greater Easterhouse, which had become notorious by the 1980s. If a car was stolen in Glasgow, Sandaig Road, where I live, was where the police looked first. Bellway took over the whole area and did a major refurbishment, lowering the height from 4 to 2 or 3 storeys. And the area completely changed, with all 270 or so of the flats being sold. They were called yuppie flats when I moved in 1990. And I gather that John Swinney, in a previous life, was involved in the project. But over the last 34 years, there has been no serious maintenance done at all. People have spent thousands on kitchens and bathrooms and double glazing, but when it comes to communal maintenance, virtually nothing. That is a problem for my 270 neighbours, but it's actually part of a national problem. We all suffer if a large part of our housing stock is not being maintained. In our case, we do have factors, but the estate has a very poor payment record, and the factors do not have the powers to ensure maintenance. We are on our third set of factors, and I fully accept that factors themselves need supervision. But in our case, and I think in many others, it is not the factors who are to blame for lack of progress. In fact, from my experience, it is even worse if there are no factors. But really, it is the whole system which is broken, and I welcome the fact that the Scottish Government is accepting this and the Scottish Law Commission is getting the ball rolling. Moving on to the other half of Graeme's... shortly, yes.
Ben McPherson.
I just wondered if Mr. Mason would agree with me, as his, a point that has been made by Miles Briggs on several occasions in the course of this year, that if we reform the Tenement Scotland Act 2004, perhaps there's also a need to make some changes to the Property Factoring Act 2011 as well.
John Mason.
Well, I confess I'm not an expert on all the different bits of legislation, but there certainly needs to be change, and I'm more than happy to be guided by others as to what that should be, but I certainly would want to give my support to change in some direction. Moving on to the other half of Graeme Simpson's motion, the report on retrofitting also makes interesting reading, meeting Scotland's retrofit challenge solutions from the industry. This raises some important points and questions, including there needs to be clarity on funding any retrofitting, how much will be public and how much private investment. The report suggests that fabric should be the first priority, as has already been mentioned, that is ensuring that a building is wind and watertight. Second should be proper insulation, and only third should we be considering the heating system. The report questions the Energy Performance Certificates, EPC ratings, and suggests that EPC assessment criteria need reforming. There needs to be a workforce which is both large enough and properly trained. Now, a pilot full retrofit was carried out in the Queen's Park area of Glasgow on a pre-1919 sandstone tenement building with 8 flats in 2020 and 2021, which brought them up to the Passive House standard. And obviously, if less thorough work was done, and at a greater scale, that hopefully the cost per unit would be substantially less. However, it did cost around £1 million for the 8 flats, which is about £125,000 per flat, which is quite substantial. So funding of both tenement maintenance and retrofit is going to be a substantial challenge. Some owners will be able and willing to pay substantial sums, but many will not, even including housing associations. So one challenge is whether owners will need grants or loans to get work completed, and what would happen to an owner-occupier in a dilapidated flat worth less than £50,000 who has no savings and only a minimum income? So I think today's debate flags up more questions than answers, but a number of us want to keep this topic firmly on the agenda No party can afford to say this problem is too difficult or too expensive. Scotland needs us to move forward towards a solution. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Mason. And I now call Cara Mochan. Ms Mochan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I also thank Graeme Simpson for bringing this important debate to the Chamber? And I want to make a contribution to the debate, which is specifically around the workforce we need now and into the future to deliver all the important points that have been raised today by colleagues in the Chamber. I've really been fascinated by the knowledge of colleagues here today, and I have actually learned a great deal. Usually, if anybody watches my dear colleague here to my left's social media, generally I can get quite a lot of information about buildings and stuff in Scotland, but it has been such an important debate. And my point, I think, is that the continuing existing of these buildings that we've been talking about tonight has really got to be done in tandem with construction training and the need to progress that. You know, because members have outlined all these important points about legislation, everything, which are really important, but we do have to have the workforce to be able to do all of this work and tackle the retrofitting challenges that we have. Over the summer, I had the great pleasure of meeting with quite a number of trades workers from a great variety of trades and from a variety of backgrounds across my south of Scotland region. And young workers in particular recognise they need the skills to meet the challenges to reach that net zero and deliver on this retrofitting of buildings now, but way into the future. And there's lots of skills that they need to develop. But I have heard a consistent message from businesses and from workers across the sector that the Scottish Government must try to really set policies to establish clearer training routes and investment, in particular local training, and to drive an understanding and a desire to save some of the skills in that craft industry. I've actually raised it in the Chamber before, the challenge for young apprentices in accessing local education around this and indeed allowing us to keep those skills because people seem to find it difficult to find some of those craft skill things to keep their competencies and qualifications and become professional in the sector. So a number of points that members have made have really made me realise that we do need to support this workforce, and I hope that the Minister tonight might consider some of the points that have been raised with me. I'll just be brief, but that we need to champion some of these skills from a very early age, from primary school, in fact, to make sure that people see them as a lifelong career and see them linked to the future of our environment and our want to get to net zero. That we need to address perhaps some of the further education complexities that there are around for apprentices, with the long distances that are required to get some of the skills needed and how we support them with that. And perhaps consider a model of education infrastructure which helps people that might be challenged by that, going away and working far away, particularly if they're young. And there has been some suggestion about sort of mobile education facilities. And I wonder whether the Minister might speak with some of his colleagues in other portfolios, the education portfolio and the economy portfolio, to look at what we can do to progress that. But again, I just want to thank everybody for a really interesting contribution and thank Graeme Simpson for bringing this to the Chamber.
Thank you, Ms Morgan. And I now call on Minister Alistair Allen to respond to the debate. Up to 7 minutes, please, Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'd like to start by thanking members for their contributions and what has been a really useful debate, and particularly to thank Mr Simpson for bringing the debate to the Chamber. And indeed, I'd like also to pay tribute to those organisations involved in producing this report, Into Meeting Scotland's Retrofit Challenge. I very much look forward to meeting the 14 bodies that collaborated on the report next week to hear directly from them on the challenges we face and to discuss their recommendations to ensure the pace and scale of retrofit across Scotland matches our net zero ambitions. I accept also that this is something that requires cross-portfolio working within government. And I'd like to thank all of those involved in the Scottish Parliament Working Group on Tenement Maintenance, including Graeme Simpson, as convener of that group, for their continued work. One of the group's key recommendations was to instruct the Scottish Law Commission, as has been mentioned, to undertake a reform project on compulsory owners' associations for tenement properties. We welcome the discussion paper published by the Commission and look forward to receiving further recommendations from them next spring, as well as their draft bill. On the issue of tenements, which I think rightly the debate focused in on, I would to pick up on Ben McPherson's point about this area, which I know is important to him, given that pretty much his whole constituency consists of old tenements, and would refer to the existence, or to the recommendation rather, of a short life working group, which I hope will look at new ways, or lead to new ways, of providing information to owners in tenement properties on everything from communal heating to energy efficiency measures. Yes? Yep.
Anne Possibly?
In trying to find a way forward in establishing this best practice, does he recognise the work of Under One Roof Scotland in providing that interface, a one-stop shop for advice, and also organisations like the Local Home Retrofit Co-op that's been established in Glasgow since 2021, which has been a great example of how you can take forward that kind of building of confidence between owners and contractors and bring people together and really build that sort of best practice, and it's kind of something we really need to scale up.
Minister.
Yes, I would very much wish to acknowledge the work that's been done by those organisations, and the Government do also aim to publish a future public consultation on some of the very issues we've been talking about, in particular on new cross-tenure housing standards. Any future legislation that's been talked about today should, I agree, consider the recommendations of the Tenements Maintenance Working Group. And it's worth saying that the Tenements Act 2004 was amended in 2009 to include the installation of insulation, but I accept there's a continuing need to engage on that issue. Presiding Officer, as Mark Griffin pointed out, we know that around a fifth of Scotland's emissions come from our buildings, and to address this we must work to improve the energy efficiency of our homes and transition them to clean heating systems. And we must do this at scale and pace, but also vitally in a way that is fair and just and brings the people of Scotland with us. The publication of the report discussed today serves as a timely reminder of the importance for joined-up policy making to achieve all of that. And as Paul Sweeney, I think, pointed out, or Paul Sweeney was able to do, to provide a historical context for all of this, was really valuable, as well as pointing to the intrinsic value of our tenement properties across Scotland. Legislation can certainly play a vital role in driving this transition. The First Minister's recent announcement in the programme for government to bring forward a Heat and Buildings Bill will be a significant step forward in this journey. The bill will be a significant means of setting a long-term direction of travel that is deliverable and affordable to households and businesses, and it will also provide certainty to building owners and to the supply chain. We also plan to publish a heat and... I will, yes.
Graeme Simpson.
Thank you for taking the intervention. I just wonder if he'd agree with the very good point made by Ben McPherson on the Heating in Buildings Bill, that it really needs to work with tenement law. So the government may need to look at what's in that bill to make sure there is flexibility for when tenement law comes along. And while I'm on my feet, if I could just thank everyone for taking part. It's good to see such interest in the subject. And if anyone wishes to be part of the Tenement Maintenance Working Group, please let me know.
Minister.
Thank you for that. Well, it is important that legislation horizon scans for anything that might be on coming in the future, but certainly in its own right, the Heat and Buildings Bill, I hope, will be relevant to tenements, and we certainly plan to publish a Heat and Buildings Delivery Plan next year, which will set out some of the foundations for a clearer path towards 2045 targets. Yes.
Ben McPherson.
Just very quickly to build on the point made by Mr Simpson, the point I wish to emphasise is that if we do not have tenement law reform that obliges tenement owners to organise in an owners' association and to be able to obtain and raise the finance together, then practically delivering on a 2045 target could be very, very difficult in a tenement property where organising and getting all those owners to agree a position is as difficult as it is today.
Minister.
I certainly acknowledge that we're not going to reach 2045 targets unless we include tenement properties, and that has to be part of our thinking going forward. So today's debate is very useful in raising some of these issues. Presiding Officer, I may be running out of time here, but just to try and touch on a couple of the other points that have been made. Carol Mochan made some very important points about skills, and I think it's also worth saying that we have, in fact, 2023 Energy Scotland grant and loan scheme, which has funded significantly more installations of heat pumps in Scotland per capita than the boiler upgrade scheme in England and Wales, in fact, almost double the rate. And, of course, that has implications for skills, which the government's very much alive to as well. The Independent Green Heat Finance Task Force, which will be publishing its Part 2 report shortly, has been considering some of the barriers constraining private finance provision for installing clean heating systems, identifying opportunities to develop new products along the way. And also, I'd like to draw attention to the importance of the EPC reform and the role of other assessment methods, and that's something that was rightly raised in the report. We're aware of the limitations of EPC, particularly in regard to providing recommendations to homeowners, and we are considering the role of other assessment methods to improve the situation. Presiding Officer, to conclude, retrofitting existing homes across Scotland, not least tenements, to make them warmer and more energy efficient and to transition them to climate-friendly heating systems is a vital part of all of our plans and our responsibility to face the emergency that we face in climate terms and to meet our net zero ambitions. But we remain clear that we will achieve this in a way that is proportionate, fair and just for everyone, including people living in Scotland's tenements.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes the debate, and I close this meeting.